afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I have the privilege of introducing Mr. Arvind Datar. He is a senior advocate of the Madras High Court and the Supreme Court of India. And apart from having a law degree, he is also a qualified cost and works accountant. Mr. Datar set up his practice in 1984 in Madras High Court and now specializes in taxation, company and constitutional law. He is the author of a commentary on the Constitution of India, second edition, Guide to Central Excise Law and Practice, Central Excise Procedures, and has written over 150 articles for various journals and newspapers. He is the general editor of the prestigious Ramaya's Guide to Companies Act and the chief editor of the seminal book, the 10th edition of Kanga and Palkiwala's Law and Practice of India. All these books are a must in every law firm's legal life. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Arvind Datar, an outstanding lawyer and a great human being, to speak.
I must thank all of you for spending a Friday evening listening to a lecture on corporate frauds. Before I go further, I must tell Suchita, Dalal and Devashish that they mentioned some astute lawyer who asked 6 questions. May I make an RTI application and know the name of that lawyer? This lecture was, as Suchita Dalal mentioned, was being postponed from time to time ever since the Sahara judgment came. And I could not speak earlier because I was busy with the 10th edition of Kanga and Palkiwala's income tax, and I kept postponing this particular lecture. In fact, I had stopped going to most of the high courts so that I could devote more time at the last stages of the book. Finally, this lecture was fixed on January, and by a happy coincidence, the book also was ready by December. So she suggested, why not have a book launch? And I was quite not very sure about it, because except that Courtroom Genius released, none of my books had a book launch itself. And perhaps people in Chennai are more shy about these book launches and so on and so forth. My senior told me that lawyers are supposed to be shy people. And even today we hesitate going before the television. Not anymore. Before I start the lecture, Mr. Bapu Malcolm asked me to first tell the audience, what does one mean by fraud? He said, your topic is corporate frauds, but what do you mean by fraud? Well, I never thought about that. I thought all of us assuming that we know what is fraud. But I think it's an important point he raises. You know, Victor Hugo always said that when you speak, define your terms. Now, as far as fraud is concerned, I'm just sorry to be slightly legalistic, but I'll answer his question. Fraud is defined in Section 17 of the Contract Act and consists of 4 components. First is suppressio veri, suppressing the truth. When is fraud practice? One, if you suppress the truth. Second, suggestio falsi, you make a false suggestion. The third ingredient in Section 17 is making a promise without intention of keeping it. That is fraud. And the last is an omnibus clause, any other act fitted to deceive. Any other deceitful act is fraud, because as one law lord said, one cannot anticipate or one cannot limit the human ingenuity to commit more and more types of fraud. And interestingly, the explanation to this section says, whether silence amounts to fraud. And the answer is, silence will amount to fraud if there is a duty to speak. So this is the meaning of fraud: suggestio falsi, suppressio veri, breaking your promise, and any act fitted to deceive. So I think I have answered your question. Now let me go straight away to the subject. After practicing for 3 decades, one thing which I was repeatedly struck was the enormous delay in bringing the guilty to book. One almost paid a premium on defaulters, and I kept asking the question why. I've been addressing seminars, making representations to the Law Commission and so on, but with little avail. Before I come to India, I'd just like to tell you a short story. All of you must have heard of Rajat Gupta, who was the first non-American president or chairman, managing director of McKinsey and Company. And if you read his life, it's almost a fairy tale. He was a person who was orphaned. He went to IIT Delhi, he went to Harvard Business School, joined McKinsey, and in 1994, he became the president of McKinsey, or the managing director of McKinsey, at just 48. He ultimately left McKinsey in 2007. And if you read his life, he seems to be an all-rounder, brilliant at academics, in dramatics, student leader, a spectacular achiever in every sense of the word. But three phone calls, just three phone calls, finished his career. After 2007, Gupta was on the board of Goldman Sachs and Procter & Gamble and various other companies. He was also the founder of the International School of Business. He was in various charities and trusts. He was a personal advisor to Bill Clinton and Obama and so on. A charmed life. In September 2008, he attended a board meeting via conference call with Goldman Sachs, and he learned that Warren Buffett was going to invest $5 billion in Goldman Sachs. Warren Buffett's company, Berkshire Hathaway, was going to invest $5 billion in Goldman Sachs. He got this news at 3:45 in the afternoon. And all of you who watch CNBC or other program know that the New York Stock Exchange closes at 4 p.m. every day. 16 seconds after he put the phone down, he makes a call to Raj Rajaratnam. They speak for about 45 seconds to a minute. 2 minutes before the stock exchange closed, Raj Rajaratnam places an order to buy 300,000 shares of Goldman Sachs just 2 minutes before the exchange closes. He is able to get only 200,000 shares. And Goldman Sachs makes the announcement after 4 p.m., normally they make the announcement after the exchange closes, that Warren Buffett, the legendary investor, is going to put $5 billion into their company. The share price goes up by almost $4 per share overnight. Next morning, Rajaratnam sells the entire 200,000 shares and makes $800,000. Second phone call. This time it is in October 2000, 1 month later. Again, there is an audit committee conference call with Gupta. He's a director. And he's told that for the first time in the history of Goldman Sachs, the company will make a loss. It had never happened before. 23 seconds later, he calls up Rajaratnam, and they speak for 30 minutes. Out of the three phone calls, only one was recorded. He speaks for just 30 minutes to Rajaratnam. The same day, Rajaratnam sells, he had remaining 150,000 shares earlier, he sells those shares. Next day, the announcement comes that Goldman Sachs is going to have a quarterly loss. The share prices drop. This time, Rajaratnam doesn't make a profit. He avoids a huge loss by selling his shares on the basis of presumably this information. And the final killer was in January 2009, when Rajat Gupta, like so many industry leaders, is in Davos, as they call it, the World Economic Forum, which is again going to be held from 22nd January to 25th January this year. This time he gets a call from, he has a conference call with Procter & Gamble's board of directors. He gets the news that Procter & Gamble is going to do badly that quarter, whereas the market was expecting Procter & Gamble to report huge profits. The reality was just the opposite. He puts the phone down, but calls Rajaratnam 4 hours later. Rajaratnam has no shares of Procter & Gamble. He sells short. He sells shares which he doesn't have. Next day, the announcement comes. The prices crash. he makes a profit of a couple of $1 million. That finished Rajat Gupta. Ironically, the prosecutor was Preet Bharara, who is now in the news because of this Devani Cobra Gadde incident. They totally launched 70 prosecutions, 70 cases and 55 convictions took place. But the point for today's talk is the trial of Gupta started with a charge sheet in October 2011. The trial starts in October 2012, and on the 8th of January 2014, just 1 year and 2 days before, he is sent to 2 years in prison. That's the speed at which the conviction takes place. And this is not an isolated example. If you study these things, these subjects, you'll find Jeff Skilling, for example, who was the Enron managing director, also a very flamboyant personality. His trial started on January 30th, 2006. And in May 2006, he's convicted. A month later, he's sentenced to 24 years in jail for the Enron scam. Ironically, Fortune magazine 4 times made Enron as the most admired company, but this is exactly what happened. But the point I'm making is this is the way in which people are convicted, which perhaps prevents so many other persons from following that particular path. Now let us come to Chennai. In the 90s, you had large number of non-banking companies. Now typically non-banking companies basically financed motor vehicles, scooters and things, assets like this, which are perhaps too small for the banks and too big for the pawnbrokers. So they require non-banking financial sources who can easily deal with the non-organized way in which the motor vehicle sector, the truck market operates. But as the non-banking companies grew, you had specialized non-banking companies who got into teak plantations. They had the famous Anubhav teak plantation where you invest money, they plant teak trees on your behalf. And the point is that by planting 10 saplings of teak trees, you'll get, after 10 years, huge teak trees which are expected to sell at several thousand rupees per cubic meter, and you will make money. This was Anubhav Notations thing, and believe me, he had more than 1 lakh investors who bought the teak plantations and investment bank. Then one person had a goat teak project. You pay 1,000 rupees, he puts 5 saplings and buys a goat. So these kind of combinations came on. And we also have a system, I don't know if you had in Bombay, we got NIDHIs, which is a particular legal entity in Tamil Nadu, where basically it's a mutual association, NIDHIs, like for example the Palghat Permanent Fund, the Mylapore NIDHI Fund. What they do is, they're basically small savings institutions which are mutual. So if I want to raise money, say for my daughter's marriage or some other program, I'll pledge jewels, take money on interest. And if you see, basically NIDHIs, they can't go bust because they give 75% of the jewel as security. So security always more. But the plus point of NIDHIs was the ceiling limit on fixed deposits did not apply. So they could give 18% interest, 20% interest. And we had the biggest NIDHI, the Royapettah Benefit Fund, RBF as it was called, which raised 440 crores in the 90s from 1,92,000 depositors. I knew because I was later when the company went bust, I was the government nominee director for some time. So this was the kind of company. Now you're supposed to use this money for mutual benefit, a family meal, education and so on. But here was this NIDHI financing distilleries and breweries, financing 5-star hotels and so on. Look at how the regulation system works. In September 2009, RBI makes a complete check of this organization and says everything is fine. And on the 5th of November 1999, the company goes bust. Now, in Madras, 1100 crore rupees were lost by depositors. 4 lakh depositors, so let's say 4 lakh families, saw their savings wiped out. And I remember as a director of RBF, we used to get heart-rending letters saying that my husband died in the Kargil war, I urgently require money, somebody wants money for a leukemia, chemotherapy and so on and so forth, and there's nothing we could do without the court's permission. But the point is 1100 crores were lost, 4 lakh depositors, and a avalanche of company petitions in the High Court asking for relief. What did the High Court do? For the first time, We had a wonderful judge called Justice Jayasimha Babu, who made lawyers as administrators because the liquidator could not handle the volume of work. So lawyers became administrators and they worked with the liquidator to recover money. And I'm happy to say that many lawyers did a wonderful job. In some companies, they were able to get 100%. In Mercantile Credit Corporation, where I was the amicus curiae, we returned 60% in the rupee, 60 paise per rupee, and so on. But many companies got nothing at all. Keeping in mind the magnitude of the fraud, the Madras High Court started what is called the Economic Offences Wing, EOW, somewhat based on the Serious Frauds Office in Scotland, that saying that economic offences are special. Most police people know to deal with theft, rape, murder, etc., human body offences, but this is a separate genre, so we require specialised people. There was a police academy. In the police academy, myself and some colleagues, we gave lectures on company law. Chartered accounts were brought in and they taught the police officials the basics of accountancy. After 14 years, not one conviction. Not one conviction. In the tea plantation, the chairman was one Natesan. You see, in Madras, you've got a very particular provision. You have a prefix. You see, you're not just called like Mr. Natesan, he's called Anubhav Natesan. Like, there's a very famous lawyer who used to get a lot of goods released on the Customs Act. In those days, in Customs Act, he would file a petition, get the goods released on furnishing bank guarantee and furnishing bond. So he's called Release Tyagarajan because he got the goods released. There was a famous murderer, Shankar, who he had a series of killed number of ladies, and he was an auto driver, so he's called Auto Shankar. So like Silk Smita, you must have seen. So this is a kind of peculiar thing of Madras. So Anubhav Natesan, he was arrested. He was in jail for 10 years. Why? He never applied for bail because he knew if it come out, he was expected to be bumped off. So he never applied for bail for 8 years. Finally, after 10 years, the police said, made him apply for a bail and released him on bail. I spoke to his lawyer this morning. Till today, no charge sheet has been filed. And Anubhav Natesan, in jail, learned yoga, became an advanced guru in yoga, and was the yoga teacher for the entire 2 year jail in Tamil Nadu. So, at the end of the day, there were no convictions at all. Now, what amazes me is this. If you take the Companies Act, 58A of the Companies Act simply says that if you don't repay the deposit, it's a very peculiar section, unintended humor. The first part of the section says, if I don't pay the deposits, what must the magistrate do? He must impose a fine of twice the deposit amount, collect the deposit, pay 100% to the depositor and keep 100% for the state. Now if the company cannot pay even 100%, where is the collection of collecting 200%? That apart, the second part is important. You can sentence him to jail for 5 years in prison. 5 years imprisonment. In my life, I have not seen anybody go to jail for not paying a deposit. I was doing the work for Dhanalakshmi Bank, Dhanalakshmi Finance, and criminal complaints were filed in 3 cases. The moment a deposit is filed of, say, Mr. Basu, the company goes and pays Basu 40,000 rupees in repayment, that complaint is dropped. So, which is wrong. The moment the deposit is not being made, offense is committed. There's no compounding. Not a single conviction. And I've been telling in the police academy and other places, in Dhanalakshmi Finance, for example, 16 witnesses. Why? They require only a document to show that this deposit of Mr. Basu has not been paid, and that's enough for the conviction. And I had a discussion with Mr. Jethmalani also on this, and he said, you're absolutely right. The whole trouble is they make 30-40 witnesses and the trial never starts, and the trial just goes on and on. This is the tragedy as far as deposits are concerned. Now let me go to the next case of Satyam. What I'm trying to emphasize is, we have got the laws, we have got the regulations, and the basic sections are not implemented. Now, as far as Satyam is concerned, again, I speak from slight personal knowledge because we are now doing the income tax case after Mahindra took over. What did Satyam do? What actually happened in Satyam? The bombshell came on 7th January or 9th January 2007 when Ramlinga Raju said that all the accounts are fudged. He openly, the board, if you read the board letter, it's on the website. The board letter says that fixed deposits are non-existent? I tell you, it's interesting. What exactly does a very unusual thing? It's a question of you tell a thousand lies to cover up the first lie. That's the kind of thing what happened. He had fictitious deposits. So I've got fixed deposits of, let's say, 1,000 crores. On 1,000 crores, I show an income of, let us say, 120 crores, 12%. So 120 crores is my income. Under the mercantile system, income accrues. It is shown on the balance sheet, I got 120 crores. I have to pay tax on that. I have not had the income in the first place. How will I pay 35% tax? So now you have to go to plan B. What he did was, he started showing that he has got foreign contracts where he has earned, let us say, 150 crores of income. And if you get income abroad, you get a tax credit certificate that can be adjusted against your income tax in a very simplistic way. So whatever is the fictitious Indian income, to offset the tax, he would reduce the taxable income with the help of tax resident certificates and reduce his tax liability. But he took the trouble of paying a few crores every year. Now this went on and on. And pardon me. There's a lot of problems because they said that even the bank certificates were forged and so on and so forth. I was just trying to explain the broad parameters of what happened. You're right, bank had to give TDS. Now, the very interesting part. By this escalation, over a period of 6-7 years, in the last year before they went bust, he had shown totally 5,200 crores of fictitious income abroad. Then, at beyond the point, the balloon simply cannot keep on expanding, it had to burst. Today morning, Bank of India says he has been convicted for income tax fraud. He and his 14 members have been, his family, his wife, etc. have been convicted. But I don't know why it took 7 years to do that.
Sir, but the news story is yesterday, there was a Bank of India article prominently saying that the CBI is unable to file a proper charge sheet.
No, I'll come to that. No, they have filed it. That's not correct. The CBI has filed a charge sheet. They have filed charge sheets. All trials are pending. The income taxes. Now, I mean, the question is the company fraud, corporate frauds, and why the corporate frauds continue. Now, if you take the Companies Act, there is a simple section of just three lines. Section 628 says that if there is a false statement in any document, prospectus, balance sheet, profit loss account, or any other record meant for the provisions of this Act, the person can be sent to jail for 2 years. As simple as that. And it's not for me to advise, but I was always baffled as to why you required to keep the man in jail for so many years when you can simply show that, look, by his own admission, his balance sheet is fudged, his profit and loss is fudged. It's a case of open and shut case, as we call it, and convict him for 2 years. Not done. So I can keep multiplying examples where people have completely committed frauds and nothing has happened. But what is the truth? If you come to Madras, the Metropolitan Magistrate Court is the company court. You have case after case of utterly frivolous complaints. Field Marshal Manik Shaw was the director of a company in Hyderabad. He was an accused in the that Hyderabad company was there, and there they had registered office in Chennai, but the main factory was in Hyderabad. You know what is the gross offense committed by Manik Shaw and all the other directors? He was the chairman of the company. In the balance sheet, the figures, instead of being shown in lakhs, were shown in millions, or vice versa. So everybody was prosecuted. Now, is that the thing to file? You have 100, if you take the website, out of 10,000 cases, 10,200 cases, 9,900 and something, almost 98% cases are compoundable offenses, not filing the balance sheet, not filing the record. There are not even half a dozen cases on Section 628 for fraud, etc. And I'll just tell you as to how it doesn't work with the story of two gentlemen from Chennai. I'm sorry, because if at all they have contributed, Chennai has contributed, they have contributed to the two convicted persons for prospectus fraud. The name is Srinivasan and Chari. In 1936, they made a public issue and raised the astronomical amount of 1,36,000 rupees in a public issue. The company was Indian Sugar and General Industries Corporation. There was a false statement in the prospectus. matter went to trial. The magistrate court ignored, convicted them. Srinivas was sentenced to 18 months jail. Chari sentenced to 12 months jail. Maximum imprisonment for fraudulent statement in prospectus is 2 years under section 63 and section 628. But Srinivasan 18 months, Chari went for 12 months. I read both judgments. I don't know why this was a difference. They could have made both 12 or both 18, but this was what the sentence was. It came before the Madras High Court. The Madras High Court confirmed the conviction. Now, when I've given this lecture, I've asked people, what is so unique of Srinivasan and Chari? And the answer, ladies and gentlemen, they are the only two people I know of who have been convicted for a fraud in prospectus. Reported case of the High Court, maybe some happened in some magistrate courts, I don't know. And this conviction took place in 1938, affirmed by the High Court in 1943. We are now in 2013. I think you must have written several articles about vanishing companies. I don't know if anybody in Bombay can tell me, was any case filed in the magistrate court which led to conviction. This is the unfortunate part as far as the corporate fraud is concerned. Now, as far as the Sahara is concerned, I will not call it a Ponzi scheme because of the matter is sub judice. The matter is still pending in the Supreme Court. So, I just speak on the facts. I don't make any value judgment about that company. That is for the Supreme Court to decide. But what is, because people have often asked me what exactly is going on, how long is this case going to go on? And even my wife is wondering as to when this case is going to end. Because we had the matter in the SEBI appellate. In fact, to tell you the truth, perhaps they asked a lawyer from Chennai to appear because there was nobody else in Delhi. Everybody was briefed in the Supreme Court or whatever, I don't know. So, first, what is this short point? Because all the reading Sahara, what is this case about? You know, you have shares, you have debentures.
Sahara, what happened was, they have had brushes with the law. I don't want to go into. As far as the case which I've been dealing with now for almost four and a half years, you know, as I said, there are shares and there are debentures, and there is a combination called optional fully convertible debentures. And these two companies started raising monies from the market for optional fully convertible debentures. There's a company called Sahara Real Estate and there's a company called Sahara Housing. And the prospectus, the draft prospectus, said that they want to raise this money to put up ports, airports, townships. Very ambitious projects. And it all started with one postcard or one letter written by a chartered accountant in Indore, who wrote a letter saying that some other Sahara companies are in trouble, kindly see what this scheme is all about. And that's how the whole thing started going forward. There are other details, but I'll just give you a broad picture. Very interestingly, what they said is, how much money you want to raise? 40,000 crores, 20,000 crores per company, they want to raise 40,000 crores. When will the scheme come to an end? We don't know. When we reach 20,000 crores, we'll close the scheme. So it's normally a prospect is open from 10 January, it will close on 31st January. All of us know, right? The closing date is known. Here they said the closing date is when we collect the money. So theoretically, if you collect the money in 2020, your closed scheme will close then. So they said that's the thing. They took an opinion, and believe me, this is based on opinions of some eminent lawyers and Supreme Court judges, which said that this particular option fully convertible debenture will not come within SEBI's jurisdiction, it will come within the Ministry of Company Affairs. So it goes to Ministry of Company Affairs, there are not much of regulations. If you're a SEBI company, then you have to file so many returns, you're subject to so many checks and so on and so forth. That's how the battle started. The whole thing was, who will regulate this 40,000 crore issue? Will it be regulated by SEBI or will it be regulated by the Ministry of Company Affairs? The matter was referred to one additional Solicitor General. He said it will come under Ministry of Company Affairs. It was then referred to another law officer. He said no, SEBI will have jurisdiction. Then referred to the minister. Minister says, I agree with the view that it will come to the Ministry of Company Affairs. Despite that, SEBI issued a notice and said that please give all this information. Mr. Parasaran, the Attorney General, always tells me that every case is a horoscope. And sometimes there is a destiny for a case, and you find that you make a series of steps which leads you on to one step to the other. So perhaps this case also a horoscope. For some unknown reason, a notice issued in Bombay is challenged in the Allahabad Lucknow bench, which gives a stay of the notice. Now, they wanted to move the Supreme Court to vacate that stay because the notice is stayed, nothing further can be done. The notice issued in December, the Lucknow bench gave a stay. In January, we moved the Supreme Court to vacate that stay. That's how I came into the picture. And one thing led to the other. And the Supreme Court said that, look, let SEBI decide whether it has jurisdiction or not, let it go back. So SEBI said, yes, we have jurisdiction. We went to the SEBI Appellate Tribunal. By that time, they had collected 17,000 crores in one company and another 7,000 crores in another company. 24,000 crores had been collected. The SEBI Appellate Tribunal said, your entire scheme is wrong. It's a public issue. You should not have done this without the permission of SEBI. It's not a private issue, because Sahara's point was, I never asked the public to buy. It was a private scheme. And the SEBI Appellate Tribunal remarked, how can you have a private scheme with 3 crore investors? In fact, the chairman remarked that this is like all Indians are my brothers and sisters. You know? So the whole parivar is India. That was the remark by the judge in the tribunal. He said, this is like Har Bharat Mera, all Indians are my brothers. We take that pledge, you know, all Indians are my brothers and sisters. And I remember in a lighter vein, we were in school, we used to take the pledge that all Indians are my brothers and sisters, and we would just be very careful and say all are my brothers and sisters except about 50 girls. You know, so we had to be careful, make reserves and provisions. So anyway, that apart. So this is what the Sahara case. Now the matter goes to Supreme Court. And Supreme Court, when it went to the Supreme Court, what we SEBI urged was, what are these debentures? They are going to be repaid in 2018, 19, 20, 21. They are 10-year debentures. And the worry of SEBI was, if you are going to repay them in 8 years, 10 years and so on, what is the security the depositors have? Because the scheme is open-ended, we have no information of where the money has gone. So the then Chief Justice Kapadia, he asked them to file an affidavit as to what you have done with the money. And he said, show the assets, because the SEBI tribunal said, refund all the money within 4 weeks. So Sahara came and said, no, we invested the money. Then Justice Kapadia said, please file an affidavit where you invested. Now they gave a list of all the places where they have invested. And if you see the affidavit which is given, 64 projects in 64 cities, 37 projects in 37 cities, Andy Valley, this, that. Whatever it is, they given an affidavit of where they invested the money. So they told the Supreme Court that don't worry, money is safe. The value is more than 45,000 crores of the assets because land prices have gone up. So if at all we have to repay, there is more than enough assets available, depositors are safe. Most important of all, they told the Supreme Court that till 2016-17, we don't have to repay anything to anybody. The earliest redemption starts only at that point of time. Fine, the case went on. We disputed the valuation. Again, each case has its horoscope. So I came and told the court that, look, the valuation seems to be suspect. So the counsel for Sahara said, let's not keep on arguing about valuation, 10,000 crores, 40,000 crores. Let's hear the main case together. Let's hear it together. For some unknown reason, Justice Kapadia asked me, Mr. Datar, are you willing to work in the vacation? Are you willing to work in the vacation? I said, yes, I will. So he said, okay, I'll fix the bench. I'll arrange the bench for the vacation and you come. And he's put up the case, unheard of in the Supreme Court history. He put up a case of fine hearing. He said, I was in court just before the vacation started. He told me that, look, 30th May, item 1, I will arrange the bench, be ready with the case, and please inform Mr. Nariman that it is going to start on that day. They tried to take an adjournment, they said nothing doing. 30th May to 16th June, except for Saturday, Sundays, we argued the case non-stop all those days. And the Supreme Court finally confirmed the tribunal and said, refund all the monies, etc. Now what is the problem? It's very simple. Now the problem is, we got the DVDs from Sahara. our main contention for the Supreme Court, which is there in the paper today, you collected 24,000 crores. You invested in various properties. You told the court, I don't have to refund at all. What's the problem? Sahara now took the plea that, look, out of 24,000 crores, I've already refunded 22,000 crores. So only 2,000 crores remaining. Therefore, I will give 2,600 crores plus extra 2,500 crores. So 5,000 crores I will pay. Remaining I have paid. This is what they have taken a stand in the Supreme Court, that everything is paid. Now this is contrary. Our stand is, it is contradictory. On the one hand, you say nothing is to be paid till 2016. After the judgment, you come and say, I have repaid everything. Then they said, no, no. If you now ask me to pay again, I have already paid. If you ask me to pay again, where will I go to pay the money? I have put everything in the assets. Again, we pointed out that in the tribunal, you said, we have sold all the assets and repaid the depositors, because 20,000 crores, even a large company doesn't have 20,000 crores to pay unless you raise it from the market. There will be some news in the market. What is pending now in the Supreme Court is, we have told the Supreme Court, and that's what they have to give in the next 2 weeks. You say that you have refunded 22,000 crores. All I'm asking is, the DVD shows the money has come from Sahara India, gone to these two companies, then it must have been invested, but the return flow of funds is not known. If you have paid 20,000 crores to 2 crore depositors, then the money must come from somewhere. Which property did you sell? Your sold properties worth 20,000 crores, so there must be transfers through banks. It can't be in cash. Where is that money? Now they keep on saying, you please see my redemption vouchers. They are giving us 120 trucks of documents and said, look, these are all the people. We saw those documents. We reported to the court that there is one Anirudh Singh. There are 1,441 Anirudh Singhs. Multiple deposits. So like that, there were money discrepancies which you pointed out. So I told the court, we'll forget about the deposit, the individuals, because we've got 50 people working, analyzing these 3 crore documents. If you can show me that you have, we are the source to repay 20,000 crores, we'll forget everything else. Then you decide what to do in the content. But first show this 20,000 crores. This is what happened yesterday. They took advantage of some language of the Supreme Court. It's not a very clear wording in the Supreme Court judgment. So Supreme Court has now said, all right, please tell us, where have you got 20,000 crores to refund to these depositors? Show us at the macro level. So this is what actually happened in Sahara. So I don't want to say it's a Ponzi scheme or a fraud scheme, but the fact of the matter is, a group can raise 24,000-25,000 crores, be outside the purview of SEBI. It can say that I will collect money from 3 crore depositors and call it a private placement. And ultimately, now after this case happens, we are in the contempt petition. Will a prosecution be filed? Will a charge sheet be filed? We don't know what will happen. So what started in 2008 is still at the final stages in 2014. But mind you, Sahara is an exception. It has moved tremendously fast in comparison with the other cases which have been filed, which have been lingered on for years and years. So this is what I mentioned about the corporate frauds. Now what bothers me as a lawyer dealing with companies and so on the one hand, you don't prosecute known cases of fraud, easy cases of fraud, don't reach convictions, and therefore you generate contempt for the law. The other thing which bothers me, which Mr. Dastur mentioned in the earlier thing, is the viciousness with which the tax department is now collecting more and more revenue. And I must mention this, because this is a very serious problem which people like MoneyLab, etc. must take up. You have the NAREGA scheme, you have the welfare schemes, you require insatiable need for money. What do? You keep on attacking the organized sector for more and more money. I've been practicing for 30 years. I believe that, like Pareto's 80-20 rule, 80% of black money must come from 20% sources. Today in Tamil Nadu, if my son wants to be a doctor, it is 1 crore 80 lakhs to become a radiologist, guaranteed up to MD. If he has my genes and my limited intelligence, even then he will go up to MD for 1 crore 80 lakhs. Is it by check? I got a friend of mine, we walked to Tirupati, he's India's leading neurophysician. He said his entire medical college cost his father was a registrar of cooperatives, cost him not more than 2,000 rupees for 5 years. Today a medical college is 1.8 crores for radiology. Why? I believe that generates more money, is more lucrative. So the basic attractive things are orthopedics, cardiology, gynecology and radiology. Now, I have not seen any such college. There's a sting operation where a person was found to take 40 lakhs, nothing happened. One thing puzzles me, I can share it with you. Every few days we get a hearing, you know, Mr. Datar, Commissioner of Income Tax, Patna, has been found with 6 crores in his house. So and so found with 20 crores in his house. What has happened to them? Have you prosecuted them? Have you convicted them? Who knows? So what happens as far as income? Now I just give a few examples as to how, where we are heading, and I think all of you must raise a protest. We just take it lying down, and unfortunately the High Court also doesn't realize the gravity of the situation. Just give a few examples, because on the one hand you don't punish the known guilty, on the other hand you victimize the people who are in the productive sector, at least who are generating some wealth. They may not be completely innocent, but at least they are doing something productive. I came to Madras and I get a call at 10:40 in the night from Apollo Hospital saying they have to meet me tomorrow morning. So I said, okay, what's up? He said that they got a 43 crore demand from sales tax. So all right, I was wondering what sales tax is with Apollo Hospital, you see, because perhaps they sell medicines and so on. What happened was, one bright officer, he has to meet a revenue target. So what he has done is, he has issued notices to all the hospitals saying that every operation is a works contract. I said, how? I got a stay in the High Court, it is pending, it's coming up for hearing in February. The argument is, suppose I have a knee replacement, then that knee goes into my body, there is a transfer of property in books from Apollo Hospital to Arvind Datar, a sale takes place, and therefore it is a sale. That is not all. If I go for a simple appendix surgery and I get a drip, and this is in the show cause notice, I am not trying to generate anything in the story. The show cause notice says the saline, the sutures, etc. become part of your body, and therefore there is a transfer of property in goods, and from 2006 you claim duty. How do you work? A dhobi, a laundry man for the Southern Railway, he gets a demand of 70 lakhs saying what? Customer care service. A friend of mine bought me because he knows this person, because he irons his pants clothes also, he got a small laundry. He won the tender for Southern Railways to, I don't know if you know, they get, at least at that time, 2006-07, they used to get 20 rupees for washing bed sheets. If you go by AC sleeper, overnight train, you'll find you'll have two bed sheets, two pillow covers, one small towel and so on. They get 20 rupees per passenger for that washing and cleaning. Now that is said to be customer care service. Why? Because every passenger is a customer of the railway. You are caring for that customer, and therefore customer care service, you have committed fraud, separation. This poor man has not earned even 5,000 rupees a month. He's got a 70 lakh demand. This is how astronomical demands are sought to be made. Now, how does the industry survive? If on the one hand you keep on penalizing the productive sector, on the other you keep ignoring the corporate frauds, it augurs very badly for the country. And at the end of the day, I'm an eternal optimist, I say things must improve, but they will change only if we mobilize the change and try to make some sense into the thing. And I don't basically agree with this silly idea of abolishing income tax and doing something. It's not possible. You see, it's very easy to sit here and say every transaction the bank tax it. The other silly idea is GST, with great respect. Why do you do this? What is the problem in sales tax? It's not with the sales tax, it's the leakage in sales tax. So as I said, you basically replace sales tax by GST, you will have, and GST is supposed to be simplification. Have you ever studied the GST law? Your state GST, central GST, IGST, that is interstate GST, and this is simplification. And if you take the GST committee, it is going to be consuming the ministers of all the states, and any one minister can veto. So you never reach a consensus. So then digressing, what I wanted to say was, we are coming to a stage where we have to put our heads together and try to say that at least this madness stops, rather than going for large scale changes like GST, abolishing income tax and so on and so forth. Finally, I'll just conclude by saying that as far as corporate frauds are concerned, we now Incidentally, this year is the Companies Act 2013. The first Companies Act came in 1913, the first major act. So exactly 100 years later, they have replaced the Companies Act. I have my own comments about the act, but it doesn't matter. Their one good thing is they have increased the fines and penalties. Other important change they have made, sorry to be legalistic, they have made all these cases as summons cases. In law, there is a great difference between a warrant case and a summons case. And one reason why the income tax and custom cases don't go to trial is it's a warrant case. Now, what is the warrant case? In a warrant case, under section 245 and 246 of the CRPC, Code of Criminal Procedure, suppose they want to prosecute me for an income tax violation. If the punishment is more than 2 years, it becomes a warrant case. So they have to first file a complaint that Arvind Datar has filed a false return. Then they have to examine witnesses from the department, first round. On the basis of these statements, the magistrate frames a charge. Okay, so there's a complaint, witnesses are examined, then a charge is filed. At that charge stage, you can go to the High Court on a revision, which people do, again it stops. Now, if nothing has gone to the High Court, after the charge is framed, the witnesses are again called for examination. So the income tax officer has to come twice. So invariably what happens is, I commit an offence in 2006, and by the time my trial starts, that income tax officer either retired or he's in Bhubaneswar or in Siliguri, he's not interested in coming. I get acquitted. Lack of proof. I just tell you one shocking thing. I was in Delhi for an international seminar on fast track courts. And after this horrible Delhi incident of that lady, the people were baying for blood, saying that every case must be finished in 3 months, every case must be finished in 4 months. And a friend of mine was a leading criminal lawyer. He explained, and they had all Supreme Court judges attending, he said that, look, it's not possible to finish a case in 4 months and 5 months. It's not just the crime, it's the support system. Do you know, I was shocked to learn this, we don't have even half a dozen scientists in the forensic laboratories. Today, in a rape case, very often the evidence is the semen and so on, which has to go for DNA testing. It takes 9 months to complete the sample test. By that time it has become putrid, the entire DNA evidence has to be rejected. So ultimately what do you do? Nobody can acquit now, because the magistrate will be hauled up for having some corruption or something like that. So he simply relies on the statement of the prosecutrix, the complainant, and convicts him. This is the shocking state of affairs. So like I said, in this Companies Act, they made a wonderful amendment, they made it as a summons case. Once it's a summons case, you can file a complaint, the trial can be over in 6 months. And I really hope that they do this and make it a strong deterrent for corporate frauds. I know that the Manila Foundation is doing phenomenal work in bringing to light these Ponzi schemes, the fraudulent schemes. They are exposing people from time to time. But at the end of the day, it's a limit to what any organization can do unless the state, because the criminal law can be set in motion mainly by the state. Even if you file a private complaint, ultimately the investigation all has to be done by the state. It's not like a civil suit which you can prosecute whether you like it or not. So the state is necessary partner in that. And what happens here? The message is important. If I know that if I commit a crime, I am likely to be booked and convicted, I'll be careful. I'll be cautious. Why is there no crime? Why is there relatively less crime or less corporate fraud in Singapore? Because you know that if something happens, the odds are enormous that you'll be convicted and serve a long term in jail. You'll not become a yoga teacher. And I sincerely hope that with this new act, a beginning is made. And all I told some people, the former law secretary and so on, you don't have to go after everybody. Just take two or three sample cases. From the state of filing charge sheet to trial to conviction or acquittal, finish the case in 1 year. If you do two or three landmark cases and send major people to jail, just as an example, that will really have a tremendous deterrent effect. Until you do that, no amount of law, no amount of good intended regulations or no amount of work by Manila Foundation will ultimately help, because at the end of the day, a person wants to know whether he'll be punished or not. Sadly in India, I keep telling people that if I violate the Income Tax Act, the chances of my getting run over by a truck are more than my ever being convicted for an income tax offense. And even if ever I prosecuted, there is a settlement scheme, a Samadhan scheme, and ultimately you make a mockery of the law. With these few words, I thank the Manila Foundation for giving the opportunity. My apologies if I have been slightly legalistic and technical, but I just spoke about my 30 years experience at the bar. Thank you so much.